I'd like to introduce Rachel Wolfson from Forbes. She's going to be the moderator, and she will be talking about today's panel.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, Jimmy, again, for having us and for hosting this panel. And thank you all for coming, and I hope everyone's having a great South by Southwest. I know I am. It's been very fun so far. So like Jimmy was saying, my name is Rachel Wolfson, and I'm a contributing writer for Forbes, and I write about cryptocurrency. I also am a staff writer for Bitcoin Magazine and the Merkle. So I write about crypto. I love the space. It's been very positive for me, and I will let our panelists introduce themselves now.
Hello, my name is Tina Lee. Where do I begin? I guess in 2013, I started the leading video publication for Bitcoin and blockchain back in 2013. It was called Follow the Coin. I'm CEO and founder. We were the leading investigative and educational video content, which is also funny, syndicated directly to the Bloomberg News Terminal, probably even maybe leading CoinDesk to that. And we also hosted a bunch of conferences and did industry-wide awards gala. And so this year we're probably going to bring back the Bitball Awards Gala in 2018. So it'll award excellence in the space, and then we're now pivoting into almost like an innovation hub, incubation, and exploring new ways to do blockchain reporting in a more helpful way for the ecosystem.
Hi, my name is Safiya Nasiri. I'm the founder of Persian Woman in Tech. I've been in tech for about 16 years, and in the past 7-8 years, focused on bringing women into technology in different industries. So thank you so much to Rachel and also Jimmy for including me.
Hi, everyone. Super excited to be here among such smart people. May I honor. Hi everyone, hope you guys enjoying South by Southwest so far. My favorite topic so far was regulations in blockchain space. I don't know what about the words. We've got some very interesting conversation happening yesterday too. But yeah, my name is Silvina Kamalova, and so I got, let me see, so I'm currently helping around a company called Black Mason, where we developed the protocol level technology for recording financial obligations on blockchain. I know recording like debts and credits may not sound very shiny, but it's a very fundamental part for transforming the global credit industry. We actually just launched a decentralized app on mobile on Monday, so very excited about that. So just to be, it is a foundational level for the very first credit transaction taking place through a decentralized app on blockchain. I came to blockchain space since 3 years ago when I was building fintech practice for Ernst & Young USA. And started understanding how blockchain can be used from financial institutions' perspective. So I also do technical analysis of ICO companies, reading white papers, analyzing their technical architecture, tokens, tokenomics, understanding how they can implement blockchain in their platforms. Do they need to issue their own tokens or not? Very excited about that part. So if you guys want to talk more about that, please talk to me after the panel, because that's something I love talking about as well. I guess very excited to be in this industry, because I am very a big believer in blockchain transforming the industries and global society from the perspective of governments, economics, and culture. I think using my background to be a part of that movement is very exciting for me, and I'm very excited about this opportunity to building this and transforming this industry together with you guys. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Carol Fowler. I'm the CEO and one of the co-founders at Transmute. We have
lets you plug and play centralized and decentralized technologies. So we are not purists, and we're focused on how to let the existing commercial economy leverage the benefits of blockchain. Similarly, I think the spirit of the technology is what got me into it. I started writing about the first Bitcoin ATMs here in Austin several years ago, and then my co-founders and I were friends pitching at hackathons a few years later, fast forward, and playing with identity management on blockchain. And then we kind of transformed into an infrastructure company because we realized that to actually actualize the potential and all the kind of utopic vision and ideas that you hear about in the blockchain space, you really have to build a foundation, and we don't have that yet. So that's what we're working on.
Cool. Thank you, guys. By the way, there's one more person I wanted to thank, Mary Schulenberger. She's taking photos of this panel, so thank you. She's with a company called IQ, and if you guys want to learn more about her technology, she is available after this panel. Okay, great. So we're going to get started. So basically, I don't know if you guys read it, but last week or a few weeks ago, there was an article in the New York Times called The Blockchain Bros, or it had that in the title, and it kind of blew up, and it was taking the angle that the blockchain and crypto industry is very male-dominated, and that there's a gender divide between men and women, and that women are kind of like mistreated or looked down upon, and there's this divide. It's male-dominated. So basically, the first question that I want to start the panel off is, you know, I want to get these ladies their thoughts on that article, whether or not they think that there is a gender divide in the crypto industry, and their experiences, whether they've been positive or negative. So that's the first question.
So according to Forbes, I think it was a different article, but Forbes says that in the blockchain, about only 5 to 7% players on the blockchain space are women, only 5 to 7%. And in my everyday work, I collaborate a lot with men. I barely, I barely collaborate with any women. So there is definitely that divide. I think definitely there's not a lot of women there just yet. That being said, the Federal Reserve confirms that 60% of all personal wealth in the US is controlled by women. And today, 40% of women earn more than their husbands. So if we want to create an industry that is being accessible to the masses, and I'm speaking about one of the goals of blockchain is developing products that will be bought by users, and a lot of those users are women. So we have to open up the industry definitely to both genders, and I think we are in a very perfect position here in the very beginning of this technology to make sure that we bring more women by having these conversations, and we will speak about the specific steps later.
Well, I think it's not a divided situation. I think men are just much more eager to and are interested in new technology that comes in than women. I mean, I was super, super excited when several years ago, Tina was talking about Bitcoin and coins and currency, and you know, she is one of the few I know that went into that business without any knowledge to understand it. So I think it's more about if we can get there early as well and join the conversation. I was having this conversation early with everyone about, for example, a man, I know several of my guy friends who are having their own groups where they talk about new technology, they discuss it with each other. I don't feel that, and I was asking which one the panelists actually was joining a group that was purely about women and with the women understanding this space. And I think no one is within a group that is created by women to share that information.
We'll change that right after this.
Absolutely, and I think that's where it starts. I don't think of it as a divided. I think that we just need to take a seat as well, and we need to start, it has to start with us. So by saying I'm not part of it, well, join. We have to definitely join forces instead of just complaining about it.
The funny thing is actually, on the aside, I actually run a closed female group called Empire State, which is actually probably gonna launch a new platform soon. We have about 900 women in that conversation, and we share articles, we support one another, and I think it's the same thing. What's interesting is in Telegram and Signal and Messenger, we are all, I think, in crypto in about at least how many of these chat groups are we part of and how many people are in each one. It's staggering to think about. It is fascinating. They're all mostly co-ed, and I didn't actually notice that until today, so we will spearhead that one as a group here. And I think it is interesting because I think women are going to be, and still are, it's expensive to be a woman, let's be honest. And it's really funny, I was having a conversation about Rent the Runway and all these Stitch Fix, and you see a lot of the men are asking, why can't we have a Rent the Runway? And then there's a joke that maybe the men will just keep renting things and not buy things. But, you know, it's interesting when you look at, we're all transforming the way economies are being run and businesses are approaching consumers, and even just business stuff. And so missing men in the discussion between women, though, is a really big deficit. I find, I've been in Bitcoin for a long time. So speaking to the New York Times article, yes, Miami Bitcoin Conference, well, it was shocking to me that this year they actually had their official party, after party at a strip club. Wow. I mean, why not a co-ed strip club then?
I agree.
And how would you guys like it if we, you know, take everybody to a strip club for women? And so it's kind of this, it's this weird thing when you go someplace and those people are being objectified. But I will tell you, in the pioneer days of Bitcoin, hey, I was in strip clubs 4 out of 5 days a week, after meetings, after conferences, and that gives you a scope of growth and progress. I don't think it's going to happen that much anymore. I think dialogues like this and like talking about what might be a more friendly or fun environment for both sexes and really pushing for those. It was abnormal, but it was the regular thing to do. We would expect to not be in those situations. And then we kind of started pushing back. And this is a good reminder that we all have to engage in the discussions to say, this is uncomfortable for some people, or this isn't the right way to do business. Or there's a better way that we could all have dialogue and do business. And don't, I mean, as a woman, as men, speaking up and like changing the way, the dynamics of business and the way things are being done is important.
Yeah, I think I might have a little bit of a different perspective. I started my career in the biotech industry, specifically in orthopedic implants. And this was right out of undergrad, and one of the, I won't name the conference, but one of the first conferences I ever went to, a lot of after parties were at strip clubs, and nothing to do with blockchain at all. I think that this article was spun out of a larger movement and a larger conversation about women in tech. And my personal experience, my co-founders are male. Almost all of my stakeholders are men. And I feel incredibly included and incredibly supported, specifically in the Austin community, where we don't have very many female founders in blockchain or females involved, but there's still women in blockchain panels. It's still at the forefront of, you know, we're at Techstars and involved in some of the other incubator communities, and it's a hot topic, and it's pushed to the front often. So I think Austin in general is an incredibly open and collaborative community, so we are fortunate in that regard that topics like this get embraced early. So I've had a really positive experience, and so when I read that article, I definitely have not had the same experience as the writer was describing, although I found it to be disappointing that some of the Mad Men era practices are seeping into bleeding edge spaces like blockchain, which have the opportunity to transform kind of social contracts.
Well, actually, I think we were speaking prior to this, and nobody here has had an aggressively negative experience with all of my peers and friends. And I mean, I interviewed countless people, and they always supported me. It was just be funny that, and odd that, hey, we're in a strip club right now. And I mean, it isn't to say that they're all horrible to us, but it is a funny experience to be like, oh, well, now I'm staring at a naked woman's breasts.
Do you have something to add to that? Or
I was just going
to
say, it's that part is the disappointing part. It's not an easy environment to do business in.
Right. And to add to that, I think there are definitely gender differences between men and women, obviously. and we may approach different things differently. I am part of some Telegram groups where mostly guys are, and sometimes they forget I'm there, and I become a part of the very interesting male conversations, which are fine. Like, you know, it's okay. We all, well, women also have these conversations, and we may not necessarily want guys to see them. So there's like that aspect there as well. And yeah, trust me, those are my days. Like when I'm like, oh guys, that's how you guys talk. That's awesome. I think we have to understand that there's difference between how male act and what male like look after and women are, and you know, and for male, it would be very easy for them to go to a strip club and perhaps like sign a deal there. Actually, know a lot of guys that do that. And if that works for them, that's fine. I'm okay with that. And if you as a woman can participate in that, like, cheers to you actually, that you can get involved in the space and like not making guys feel awkward that you are there too. Because obviously, like, not, I would assume guys would feel awkward if you were there as well. But somehow I think being able to really understand those differences and also play them for your own advantage. And sometimes, yes, maybe do not go to that conversation, do not join that meeting just because the guy's going to be there, maybe like it's better for you not to go there. But I think delivering the excellence and developing products on blockchain and letting people know that you're working on these things. And I think if that's there, people will start noticing you, and they may not necessarily think about you, oh, this is a woman in blockchain, but they will start saying, oh, this is a cool person in blockchain doing cool stuff, and yeah.
Yeah, definitely, I agree with that. So basically, the next question, I think that blockchain in the crypto space is less about gender and more about innovation. Whether you're a male or female, my girlfriends in this space believe that as well. Like, if you innovate, that's all that matters. So I want to get your thoughts on that it, you know, that this is a gender neutral space and it's more about innovation, and kind of talk about how you've been innovating in the space.
Yeah, I think I'll start there, because when we were talking about this upstairs, and every pitch I've given, someone comes up afterwards to tell me that they're impressed that a woman is speaking about something so technical. It's always a woman. It's never been a man that's come up to tell me that. So I think that, you know, that's interesting. And what I generally tell them is, I'm so glad that you're excited, and I hope that you remember what I talked about. Because I'm really excited to share all the cool stuff that my company's building and working on. And if me being up there helps other women feel confident talking about what they're working on, then I'm thrilled. But I'm excited for a time when all the women in the audience, it's just completely normal to hear a woman talking about something technical.
Frankly, I've watched a lot of people in the space come up with really interesting ideas, and then you also hear every other conversation being an ICO or being a fund or raising money or investing and trading, right? And I think what's really interesting is some of the more innovative companies are with people who are not ICOing and they're raising traditional funds, right? And or they're doing a different way of approaching, you know, decentralization or using the blockchain and really making progress in exciting ways. And we're here at South by Southwest. You know, I'm from San Francisco, Seppi's from San Francisco, and Austin. The point is, this is a brand new landscape to just innovate. And innovating as entrepreneurs, like, it's crazy, it's risky, you know? And that's part of the, I guess, allure of Bitcoin, is you get to be on the frontier front lines of like creating anything out of you, like thin air, right? And it is weird, sometimes you come up with make-believe terms. You're like, well, ICO, not an IPO, got it. Crowdfunding rules, do apply, got it.
Right.
Hold on. It's kind of interesting that we threw Dogecoin stuff, and you're like, well, Dogecoin is not around anymore. And you know, you're kind of wondering, what are all these coins about? What is the point? And we're all learning together. And I think it's important that we continue to, you know, strive forward, learn together, grow together, and share knowledge regardless of gender, regardless of what project you're in, and actually get the bad actors out of the ecosystem, and then actually get back into progressing as, you know, a new technology, a new ecosystem. economy and way of being.
Well, I'll go back to what I said earlier, that as women, we would have to be part of that conversation and having a seat. And as innovators, we need to be innovating as well in every single industry. And I think that's what's missing. I was, again, so proud that Tina went into it so early. But if we all want to innovate and we want to be innovators, we have to be able to come into every single industry and educating ourselves. I think that there was an article, Vanguard actually mentioned that 20% more women invest in things they know, so their own money. So said that, if we are educating ourselves, we're going to be better innovators when it comes to any type of industry.
So I think there are a few things which we can do and should do. So I think number one is mentorship, right? All of us has, 30 minutes for coffee sometimes with someone and just like saying like, hey, like this is the industry. And like show some direction of where a person can go. Because many people, like this community, I don't know, it's like 0.0001% of the world. Not really people even know about all this stuff. And people like, today, cab driver was asking me, so what coins I should invest in? And just because I mentioned blockchain on my phone conversation. And I think just mentorship perspective. Also, another thing is, how do we involve more people from high school and colleges? How do we implement the programs there? And maybe having some events and speaking opportunities in colleges, in high schools. And number three, I think visibility. So this is a huge one. We all know women, including amazing women sitting here, who do really cool stuff in the space. And I think showcasing those by speaking about them, bringing them to the conferences, events, collaborating together, and supporting like other people's efforts from that standpoint is important. However though, and I think this is really what we're digging into here, talking about our accomplishments ourselves, women have a very hard time bragging about themselves. Very hard time. I was speaking to my friend yesterday, a guy friend, and I was like, so what do you think about this? And he told me, well, you know, we guys like really good at bullshitting. And people believe us. Like, we just like very confidently bullshitting, often. And I was like, and he told me, but you guys are not. And even though you guys know your subject, you do not either feel confident enough, but either way, you're not speaking up and letting the world know what amazing stuff you're working on. And I was like, oh, that's a very interesting point, because I find it about myself a lot. I don't really speak about like what cool stuff I've done. But I think it's very important to, number one, not only say, oh, I am cool, I am in blockchain, but actually provide some specific examples of what you've done. So people start seeing, oh, okay, so you actually done stuff. Like, guys, that's how you guys think. Okay, so you're giving me examples. Okay, now I can trust you. But also, if you're a programmer in blockchain space, obviously have your GitHub, right? GitHub up, and people can come and see them, your code. Attend meetups, attend specific events where not a lot of women go there right now, just because they are afraid to put themselves out there and feel uncomfortable maybe being among men. But these are things which we have to do. We have to start speaking about ourselves. We have to go to these events and meet people and integrate ourselves in the space.
I agree with that. I mean, I've been at South By since Thursday evening, and I've been going to a lot of crypto events, and there's been a lot of men there. But everyone's been super nice to me. They've been, you know, so happy to hear that I write about it for Forbes. So I think just, you know, we need to bring more women to these events, because they're going to be welcomed with open arms. We just need to raise awareness that, you know, this is a gender-neutral industry. So, you know, women should learn more about it and get involved, because it's such a cool space, and blockchain is the next wave of innovation. It's already here, and it's going to change the entire world and many industries. So So I think that's a really good point. We need to brag about ourselves and go to these events. It kind of leads to my next question. So a lot of this is about early innovation, I think, and a lot of, well, you know, if you're in it early, you can innovate faster, I think. So can you just talk about your experience being early innovators and what you've done to innovate blockchain and crypto space early on?
I could speak about that. Well, number one, I'm very fortunate to go across many ICO companies and look at their platforms and white papers and give them suggestions on how to make this point of that development better. So I think I have a first touch on actually products that are going to be developed in blockchain, which is very exciting. And second thing, I could say that very honored to be part of the company that developed one of the first products on blockchain. We closed our ICO in October. We already have the protocol, and we launched the decentralized app like in March. This is one of the first deliveries on blockchain space, like one of the fastest for sure. And I'm very excited about being part of that too, and actually leading the whole effort from product development standpoint and running the company standpoint. But I agree. I think this is a very exciting timing for actually, doing some cool stuff. And we're like all co-creating the whole new world here. This is a huge stuff. This is a big deal.
It's a new ecosystem.
Absolutely.
And we're all part of it, whether you're male or female.
Yeah. Well, I think it's impressive. I always like meeting people, especially in the space. I'm going to be honest. I think 80% of the space is probably has no idea what we're talking about. Let's be real. You know, it's like we're kind of learning all together, and it's really nice to see people innovate who actually are real developers, who are creating real products, really creating, you know, like fundamental new ways to approach credit, fundamental new ways to approach storage, fundamental new ways to approach banking, and I mean, point of sale is a little bit broken because of proof of work, but hopefully we can all galvanize and maybe even address that together, you know, and it's exciting. Like when I started pioneering, it was actually a consulting project. Someone was like, take a look into a mining operation. How do we approach this? And then we started follow the coin as an accidental thing because we're like, this is a hard subject to catch up on and get to know. And people are nodding their heads, right? It's like, what is Bitcoin? And then we're like, let's make it approachable. Let's make it accessible. And then it was, you know, we just kept going. We were in Boost VC. And then there is this momentum where you're in a room full of people. Look around. Actually, this is an empowering women panel. Now I want to say thank you, by the way, to Jimmy, who was like, let's do a panel on women and have a woman in every panel. And then all of you, this is actually a good 90% men. So thank you for supporting us. You know, we're all here because we want to learn together. We want to progress. We want to advance the ecosystem. We want to have these conversations. And it's been fun. Like, here we are right now, follow the point. We're considering ways to maybe come up with a better business, not a borough, but an association or like a hub or some sort of incubation so we can actually talk about how do we actually as a whole, as an entire ecosystem start, you know, why is it bad to do good business? I don't understand that. A lot of trolls on the internet will be like, well, it's decentralized, let us do whatever we want. I'm like, we're just gonna destroy the industry if we don't get a little bit more legit. It's time to get legit.
Yeah, on that note, I can talk a little bit about our experience because I think that some of the crypto hype is a double-edged sword for companies who are really trying to provide value in the economy today. We started, like normal startups do, trying to build a product, trying to get clients, got those, looked at the hype and all the money being raised and thought, you know, maybe we're really far behind. And then as we've met more and more of those peer players and companies in the space, we're realizing, no, actually we're ahead of the game because we actually have a product and we actually have customers and we're actually providing value to companies that already exist and are already doing business today. And so I think that there's a little bit of a misconception that everything has to be the Wild West, but I think the way that we get these technologies actually used and adopted more quickly is by adding them to the existing value pools. And augmenting businesses that are already successful with some of the benefits that blockchain technology provides.
Yeah, great. Okay, so now I'm curious. So I was wondering if you guys can remember the best piece of advice given to you as women in this industry by someone, whether they were male or female, but what was that advice when you wanted to get started in the crypto space, and who gave it to you?
Think back.
Yeah, I had a very good conversation with my friend. Okay.
Use your microphone.
Sorry. Yeah. kind of two advice, but it's actual one advice coming from two different people. First, a very good friend of mine. Very much respect him. Very successful. And I said, "What shall we do? What do you think?" And he said, "Don't think about this. Do your stuff, deliver value, and that is what's important. Everything else will fall in place and people will start noticing it." And yesterday's friend, and I think it kind of like blends very well together, start speaking about it too. Start somehow showing it. So.
Yeah, cool. Anyone else?
I think I just want to echo that. So in all cases in my career, whether it was men or women, it was just focus on what you're doing, focus on providing value. As a woman, I want to help all of the other women. And I think that among us, sometimes you run into people that pull the ladder up behind them. And I think this, in the spirit of the technology and the way that it has the potential to redefine some of these social contracts, it's important to not pull the ladder up. To lean in and make sure that we're providing, kind of, you know, we're paving the road behind us. And I think we have a really good opportunity to do that.
Okay, well, I love that, you know, there's that empowered people, I please say empowered women. What is it? Wait, no, I'm saying it wrong. What is it? I'm terrible at expressions, but I always try to do them. Nobody should let me do that. But it's something about empowered women make powerful women, right? And so, and it's the same with humans. And I guess there's so much, I've been blessed. I feel really blessed. I've been in the space since 2013, and I've been able to really galvanize and support women in the space. And they come back to me, and they're like, "Thank you for putting me in front of the camera. Thank you for giving me a voice. Thank you for supporting." And then I'm going, I don't know, you know, what should we embark on next? How can we help? And part of it is, a lot of them are just like, figure out what you really, anybody here, this applies to all entrepreneurs, figure out what your calling is, right? What do you actually want to do? What actually can you wake up and be happy doing? Maybe it isn't just sitting here making funds and like, you know, like making money. It's just about following what you can wake up every day and do. I don't think it's really, I mean, traders, it's fun to trade, but it's also agonizing, right? You're like, am I gonna lose my money? I don't understand. And so, you know, where is this Bitcoin tide going? It's super volatile. And so I think the biggest, best piece of advice I keep getting, especially nowadays, while we're kind of pivoting and changing our business model, is to just keep going. They're like, just don't stop. Like, whatever you do, don't get paralysis. As an entrepreneur, I think we all get paralysis. We're all entrepreneurs in this room because we're in a new frontier. And it is founder fear and paralysis. That means you're actually kind of trying to make sure that you're gonna make a real product and you're really gonna provide value, or, you know, do something that is gonna impact people. And that's a good fear, but don't let it win.
One advice that I always got is build a network around you can tap into. Having the right people around you makes such a difference in whatever innovative things you want to build or support into or tap into. Whenever I don't know about something, I can reach out to someone who can teach me or tell me more about it. And I think that's something valuable for anyone, not just women, for men as well. So I think it's just very, very much important, not just what you're building, but having people around you who you can find information from or who can advise you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, great. So I have one final question. So as we all know, there's a lot going on in the blockchain and crypto space, and I'm really excited in particular about how blockchain is transforming the gaming industry, and it just makes sense. Like, gamers get crypto, and they've understood it for a very long time because of the trading virtual currencies for profit. Anyways, I want to know what you guys are most excited about in the crypto space in terms of innovation.
I think I've said it a few times, but the spirit of the technology in terms of potential disruption for social contracts. I think personally that's the most compelling thing in my lifetime, and maybe in all of our lifetimes, it's the only time that can happen. But the technology is immutable. Or there's some immutable properties that we have to design for. And so I think that it's all the more important to have all the players at the table when we're thinking about these things. That's most exciting to me.
I think there's so many exciting industries or like technologies and movements. I think actually, I'm gonna be unpopular for saying it, but I think it's actually kind of good that we're getting some real governance and thinking. It's kind of nice to get laws. It's like, hey, we're actually being heard. This is actually such a big thing that they can't ignore us anymore. So give us the laws so we can understand them, and then we can actually build products and platforms and like funds that aren't always tiptoeing on the line of legitimacy or illegality. Nobody actually wants to, we all look good in stripes, so we don't want to be in jail. I mean, most of us. And so, you know, it's like, that's exciting to me that there's governance, right? Yeah. Like all around the world, they're thinking about how we can be accredited. What are the laws in every country, in the US? And it's kind of, we're getting a raw deal in the US at the moment, but this is probably gonna shift. And that's exciting to me that we're actually, this is becoming a legitimate industry.
Yeah, agreed.
I think blockchain as an industry has potential to fundamentally change many industries and many aspects of our life, starting from governments, economy, and art, education. And for me personally, it's about being a part of this movement where we can put the best ideas for the world and how we want the world to be shaped in place now and create that together and co-create that together.
I think it's super interesting to see or exciting to see how it's going to change the human connection and how we're going to, engage with each other and not just locally but globally. I think that's super exciting. Every time a new product comes out, we are able to engage differently. So I think that's the most interesting or exciting thing for me.
I second that, because remittances are such an interesting use case, early use case of success, right? In Venezuela, in Chile, in Africa, BitPagos and BitPesos have been going at it since like 2013, 2014, doing incredible things so that people that have incredibly volatile currencies, like you could go buy milk and one day it's $5 and the next day it's 100 because your government is so corrupt and the banking system, you can't count on it, right? Inflation is just a nightmare. And to see that remittance is working and improving lives so that people can, yes, Bitcoin's price is volatile, but it isn't so volatile that it's becoming a fundamental universal like financial tool and money. You know, it's actually the first international global currency, and that's pretty exciting.
Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, I think on that point, cryptocurrencies can play a big role in developing underserved countries, definitely, where actually the most of the world does not have access to banking services, like the majority. And providing that, those opportunities for them to take credit on blockchains, basically, like Salt Network, for example, you can take a loan there. There are other, like Request Network, you can send money to someone in different country without going through all this, opening a bank account even, because some people cannot even do that. And I think it opens up a lot of opportunities for developing those countries from that financial standpoint and giving chances to people to have access to those financial services.
For sure, yeah, helping the unbanked, definitely. Yeah. Cool. Do we have time for questions, Jimmy?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Yes, go ahead.
I'm curious about what you perceive as the values of the cryptocurrency market. How do you, how do you define those values, and how do those values then affect, the technology that's developed, affects the business models, affects the practices, because I get the sense that there's a bit of, there's not much there in terms of the values. There really isn't any discussion about what are the base ethics of the, you know, that we want to live by, what are those values that we really uphold, and how do we then make that, you know, something healthy and sustainable. I don't get that, I don't see it.
Well, according to, I have to cite, according to Vanguard again, it was stated that the cryptocurrency market is at $479 billion, where the NASDAQ market is at $20 trillion, if I'm correct. Yeah, so that's the difference right there for you right now to look at what the market value is.
I'm not talking about market values. I'm talking about the values of the community, the values that you that the community upholds or the individual businesses uphold. Because it, you know, I mean, if you're talking about strip clubs and, you know, and how they're thinking about that, I wonder actually how much space there actually is for people who are fairly marginalized.
So I talk to founders a lot, a ton of them, because we also do some advisement. And those people that are actually trying to do really good projects, like there's actually a loan project. It's really great to see people who actually want to fundamentally shift the way banking is done in a way that is more people-focused, right? And then it is nice to see people who really do want to change, like remittance, and change the game so people can have access to funds that are unbanked. And I think they are very far and few between. I think your question is actually very timely because it's a bigger question that we should be asking each of ourselves.
Yes.
Why are we in crypto, right? And that's something we should ask people who just want to like maybe crowdfund $23 million and run away with it. I won't name names. We investigated them. And these people do that. And it is a good question for all of us to think about, why are we in Bitcoin? Is it just to make a ton of money and just like be rich? And sure, that's nice, but what is the underlying ethics that this whole industry can start to adopt?
Well,
together?
If you're in it for that, what rules do you live by? If you're in it just for all the money you can possibly make, what rules do you live by? I'm just curious, what are your own, maybe, you know, better question is, how do you perceive the values that you want to uphold, and how have you seen it, the industry dysfunctional, and how would you raise it to a functional point?
Yeah, so my company, we have a utility token inherent in our product offering, and we focus a lot on the function of that, and derive our values as a team around how these new incentivization mechanisms work. And it looks a lot more like a meritocracy. And so as a team and a lot of our peers in the space here in Austin, we buy very much into the value, the contributions in, and you get value out. And I think that that's a philosophy that I see carried into business negotiations and discussions with investors, with customers. And it's actually quite different as a philosophy from any other industry that I've worked in or any other avenue in my career. So it's unfortunate that there is, you know, that the fraud comes to the forefront, but this is part of the regulation. Like this is what these laws will hopefully get rid of or at least protect and pare that down. But I think the spirit of the technology being kind of more collaborative and focused on merit is still there, and some of us are gonna start leading the way. Illustrate that more.
And from the, it's a very, very good point, and also from the value of tokens on, say, exchanges standpoint right now, I believe that we're in a very hyped market right now, and to your question, how do we even evaluate the coins? It's impossible right now, because well, it is possible, and that's what the market is doing right now, right? From 8,000 to 11 to 16 to 9, based on your demand. But again, are there any fundamental reasons for that? Not really, unfortunately. And I'm very sad to say that. But currently, the value of coins on Binance or Coinbase, Bittrex, they're not really based on any like utility value, unfortunately. And I wish it was, but it's not. Because many of those coins, number one, they do not really deliver any value. I don't want to get even to Bitcoin's value because there's like no value in it, honestly. But it has such a strong brand. It's not going to go anywhere. And also because it's being supported by a lot of people, institutions slash whales at this point. So it's not about the inherent value of the token or the cryptocurrency. I think it's more about the branding slash the news coming from China or Binance that impact the overall price of all coins immediately. So it's very emotion-based pricing strategy right now. And I really hope that we will pass this period of this overhyped interest and we'll start evaluating these coins and cryptocurrencies based on their actual inherited values, be it the token you were speaking about, or be like, for example, I really like OMG, a mystical. It really transacts the value between different countries very fast, very cheap. But look at that value on Binance. It's nothing. So, yeah, I don't think there's any way to value them right now.
Yeah.
You just have to kind of like look at the news and see, oh, okay, so China is closing the market tomorrow. I better sell my stuff right now.
Right. Also, just to, you know, another part of your question. So there's something called the World Tokenomic Forum. They're actually here at Blockhouse on 6th Street. But they're kind of creating, from what I understood, this like type of UN thing with a bunch of people in the space to kind of regulate the space, but not have it like government regulated, more like people in the space. Anyway, so they're interesting. You want to check them out at Blockhouse.
So it seems like a people first approach is an emerging value.
I think so.
Agreed.
And I think more people in the industry are kind of forming together to form things like the World Tokenomic Forum to discuss it and figure it out, so there could be like less government regulation and more people regulation. Anyways.
Self-regulation.
Self-regulation, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So right now we're coming off of a hype cycle, and hopefully you agree with this cryptocurrency stuff and blockchains going with it. And we're gonna be entering into something known as the trough of disillusionment, where a lot of these companies that are raising the same funds are gonna go out of business because they were promising something that was completely unrealistic. I'm curious, when do you think things are going to level out and real value is going to be very transparent, and all of this, you know, fear, uncertainty of doubt will kind of be washed away, and we'll be talking about the actual application of the technology versus just the markets, the new markets. So, it's timeline for that.
Oh, when do you think that will happen?
Yeah, and yeah, just kind of what you're saying.
Yeah.
So it's funny. I've been in Bitcoin since 2013. I think in October 2013, the price went soaring up from 900 to 1200 and then dropped drastically to 200. I mean, talk about like a hiccup, and a bunch of people left. A lot of the bad people, or like people who are value-centric, left the ecosystem. And then it's an unpopular thing to say, but I'm actually kind of happy that the price dropped back down to 11,000 or ish, wherever it is today. But because it went from 21,000 back down, and I think when it was at 21,000, I mean, actually 2 months ago, I got hacked, you know? SIM was hijacked, and like, it was just a mess. And I think that's fine, but when the price is high, people are hyped up and excited, and they're like wanting to be in the industry. And what's great about the price being down, or is this is a good time for the right people who want to do, you know, obligation to technology and innovation, and think about how to actually build off of the blockchain or create things that do good in the space, will actually get back to work and they'll focus, because it isn't just about monetary gain. So I think maybe in a couple years we might see even more.